That's me. Most of you know me, right?
This is me.
Yeah, I'm the invader. Watch out.
Boom. I recognize the eyes.
Let's see the hand. Let's see.
Yeah. So, Jim and I have talked a lot about this. And my original intent when I started researching this, and even as I got further into it, I really wanted to find some more modernized version of this Drake equation, and the modified version. But it was tough to find one that I could live with, and it was really tough to find any modifications to this which reached a consensus amongst experts, of which I am not one. But figuring this out was true. So I went with the original. Here's the original. Here's the Drake equation. Let's get into this a little bit. So I'm going to get my clicker to work today. Here we go. So firstly, there's the issue of detecting this stuff at all. Pretty much, you need one of these if you're going to do them. Hopefully, more than one of these. Right? Radio telescopes, and we're usually looking for radio waves. There's a setup in Mount Shasta, but this really kind of started in earnest in the 50s. And in fact, there's a particular article from Nature, September 1959, Journal Nature, searching for interstellar communications, Giuseppe Cocconi and Philip Morrison. And they said that we now have radio telescopes of sufficient sensitivity that we could detect a broadcast coming from interstellar space. And that was really all they said. They left it at that. We think our radio telescopes are good enough to find stuff. If it's they didn't even say if it's there. They just said we could detect one. Since then, lots of stuff has happened, and lots of people with radio telescopes have looked for aliens. All over this Green Bank, anybody with even one has probably tried this. I don't know if we have. Our radio telescope's been on the fritz since well before I took over as the director here. But the current state-of-the-art in trying to find alien transmissions is here, the Allen Telescope Array. This is named after Paul Allen, co-founder of Microsoft, right? Who put up a bunch of money in about, let's see, when was that? 2001. He put up some money, and they now have 42 antennas, and it's like this, on Mount Lassen up in California. So this is near the Hat Creek Observatory. Anybody been by Hat Creek? Cool place, right?
So, this is separate from Hat Creek?
It's pretty much right there at Hat Creek. Okay. And there are 42. Ultimately, they want to have 300 and something of these things set up. The more the better is essentially how that works out. But that's sort of the state of the art today. People have been trying for a while. We have yet to detect anything that is definitely not naturally occurring. Lots of things produce radio waves in this band. And one of the arguments that those guys made in 1959 was we should look in this particular range, this particular wavelength range, because that's what hydrogen will emit this, and smart enough aliens might use that. But yeah, no. We look in particular regions because we're good at it, and because you can use it for other stuff. That's why you look at particular wavelengths of radio, is that you can also look for other things. So you can justify building your telescope array to some other funding agency besides the guys from Microsoft who just have money. Right? You can justify and say, well, we can look at other stuff and for aliens. It's a double dip, right? But people have been doing it for a while. A lot of people think that the Drake equation is really supposed to address this famous Fermi paradox. There's Enrico Fermi, super famous physicist, ridiculously smart guy. And he he brought this up. So the story goes, his students were talking about this, probably a myth. It was talked about around this time, and everybody likes Fermi, he's a smart guy. And he said, okay, if there are aliens in the North, where are they? Which is a really legitimate question. A very legitimate question. And most people said, well, somewhere. And I think that the answer to this myself is actually some when. Is probably that's how I would have answered Fermi, given the time to think about it. I would have said, well, Enrico, well, it's not where are they, it's when are they, is really more the problem for talking about. But contrary to many reports, the Drake equation is not explicitly out to answer Enrico Fermi's question and address this Fermi paradox. It does kind of work on it, but that was not this guy's idea. Here's Frank Drake. And this is a quote from him when he was this was back 1961. He said he had read this paper in 1959 in Nature, and he thought about it for a while. In 1961, he set up a meeting at the Green Bank Radio Telescope Facility and invited a few people. There were 10 people there, I think, including him. All physicists, all astrophysicists. I think there was one chemist, biochemist, but I don't recall for sure. But he was putting together this meeting was to talk about the search for extraterrestrial intelligence, SETI, right? Search for extraterrestrial intelligence. And while he was trying to put together an agenda for this meeting, he said this to himself. I wrote down all the things you need. This is a giant lie. These are not all the things you need to know. But it was a start. It was a start, and he wrote it. But it was really the agenda to discuss things for this meeting. And the agenda turned into terms in what's now called the Drake equation. And that's really where this all came from. Is from his agenda. But like I said, this wasn't, this was just, hey, let's talk about aliens. Let's have a meeting and talk about aliens. It wasn't explicitly to address the Fermi paradox or anything, although it might be able to do so. So there it is. We'll talk about each of these things in turn. But really, the first thing is what's the question? This is what we're talking about. N, capital N equals something, right? And a lot of people think, well, this is what Frank Drake said, the number of civilizations with which communication might be possible. So a lot of people, when you read about the Drake equation, and this confused my research for this talk, a lot of people think, well, it's this, is there life elsewhere in the universe? That is not what we're asking. Neither is it, will we actually communicate with them? It's neither of those things. That is not what Frank Drake was after. That's not what the Drake equation is describing. But if you look into this and you Google them, you'll find a lot of people that say, oh, yeah, well, yeah. Frank Drake's up in the night because, you know, of course, it's one of these. No, it's not neither of those questions. This is kind of how I think of them. I tried to write how many aliens are emitting signals and are capable of detecting the signal from us. That doesn't mean that we see their signals or that they see ours. That just means there's a capability. That's it. I think that's what Drake is after. He's after a number of possibilities.
Well, I think what Drake was trying to say is what we're not looking for here is some extremophile by a hydrothermal vent.
Right.
We're not looking for a trilobite. We're looking for something that's capable of building a radio telescope.
Exactly.
Those are very different things.
And they can emit and detect. And detecting is a big part of that. And it's not necessarily that they do so. It's not how many are we committing, it's how many could we, maybe. I put this in here because it's really important to consider space-time. Anybody seen these light cones before? This is what these are. So this little dot right here at the apex of these two cones is the here and now. If you go horizontally, You go elsewhere in space. But in order to look back here into the past, this is the past, back here that it is, or was, rather, you can look back into this cone. So I can't really look over here in space-time. I can't do that from my position at the apex of this cone. This is elsewhere, also elsewhen, some other time, but I can't detect stuff over here. That's outside of my detection scheme. Only stuff inside this cone. And then there's the stuff that might be affected by me. Stuff that might see me from my here and now. This is the future. But so be it. Right? And then there's the, is it, so, question mark? Is it down here? Will it be up here? This is important to consider, and it's really important to consider. It might be that there are currently, elsewhere, aliens with radio telescopes trying to send it, but if they're over here, we're going to have to move our here and now before we're going to have a chance of detecting them. But fortunately, our here and now is constantly moving. This past and future light cones can envelop more stuff. But I put this in here because it's really important to consider what could we see. Even if they're there, we might have to wait a considerable amount of time. This also brings up something that was assumed by Drake and is still assumed by anyone studying this seriously, that light speed, this which is indicated on the script by this slope of this line right here, this light speed, about 3 times 10 to the 8 meters per second, 186,000 miles per second. It's assumed that we can't communicate. It is physically impossible for anyone to communicate, send information back and forth faster than the speed of light. That is an implicit assumption in all of this discussion. If that's not true, then you just as well take Drake's equation, throw it out the window, and start fresh.
You violate causality.
You might violate causality.
Okay.
You might violate causality. There are excellent reasons, causality not the least amongst them, to suspect that this really is a limit on information, how fast information can move around in the universe. Really excellent reasons. No measurement has ever been made that suspects this, but we don't know all of physics, and we shouldn't claim to. In fact, we know beans about a lot of stuff, very little. We should look into this, but implicit in the rest of this discussion is that we don't have wormholes available, we don't have faster-than-light communication or travel available at all. Which is a good assumption, because right now we don't, and we don't have any good reason to suspect that anyone else does. But if we're going to discuss it, we have to put the constraint on there. So, based on our current understanding, it's a good thing to say that. Anyway, we'll move on. So, here's this first term here. And Jim and I were discussing this earlier, and there's a lot of discussion about this term. The average rate of star formation in our galaxy. This is the first thing that Frank Drake came up with. And maybe there's a good reason for that. I think there's a compelling argument that you need stars if you're going to get life. You need that constant source of energy for life to start, but certainly to sustain life somewhere for long enough that it might get smart and build a radio telescope. This is Drake and company's 1961 consensus on the rate of star formation per year. One. Why look at a rate? Why do you care how fast stars are coming up? This is a good question. I think the core of it is probably that these people are physicists. Physicists look at rates. We want to know, we don't want to know what is that thing. We want to know, how does that thing change with respect to some other variable, usually time, right? The other reason to consider a rate is to correct later on in this equation so that you come out with a number that is a dimensionless number of things, a number of civilizations we can talk to, a number of civilizations that might detect us, right? There's a lot of thought to why a rate, but I think we should consider stars as energy input. They're rogue planets, rare ones, right? These planets that kind of roam, they're not really in a bound orbit around a star. But I don't suspect without that energy input from the star that anything's going to survive for very long on a rogue planet. So we're going to throw those guys right out. And we suspect that planets need stars. We'll get to that in the next. So this is a star formation, a picture from the Spitzer Space Telescope. It's about 6,500 light years away in Cassiopeia. This W5 star forming region, right? The classic nebula picture.
Tom, that's a very good photograph, and the first thing you notice is you don't see stars forming one by one. You have dozens of them forming all at the same time.
And so here's the problem with this one. Latest data from the European Space Agency and NASA says it's that. Now, that's considerably higher, which you think, oh boy, that's going to make our number go up by 7 times, right? Yeah, well, maybe it will, but 7 times might not help us. This is the latest data. This is state-of-the-art rate of star formation in our galaxy, as far as we know. Was it that in the past? Will it be that in the future? Was it that in the distant past? Certainly not, but you know, that's a how long ago is the question. So, really, one-ish? Between 1 and 10? What should we really call this? But we'll go with NASA and the European Space Agency. Pretty good. And we'll take Drake as a lower bound. I mean, we should be getting more stars. And why do we care? Well, we got more stars, you know, in the recent past, recent galaxy lifetime-wise, we probably had some stars forming, and maybe they've been around long enough. This is a pretty iffy thing already. But I think considering stars is good. But, of course, the big consideration is planets, right? We think that life needs planets. There's some debate on this, weirdly enough. Mostly of the non-scientist type. But there are some people out there that think, oh, well, what about people, you know, what about some civilization riding on comets or something? You know, maybe, but I think planets are a pretty good guess. Let's stick with planets. In order to have life start and last long enough to go anywhere else, then you're going to probably need a planet. So we think life needs planets. And this term, and Frank Drake, he said, how many of those stars that we formed in the last term have planets? That's what he thinks the question is. Here's their original estimate. 0.2 to 0.5. Turns out they were a little pessimistic. Yeah. We're pretty sure that, as a rule, stars have planets. This is based on recent work, the Kepler telescope. We think, and we're reasonably certain as we can be, that if you got a star, probably have planets. Now, that doesn't mean the planets are going to last very long, or the star is going to last very long, or long enough, and, you know, what kind of star? That was not something that was thought of in the last term, which is a big consideration. But I think we could include the what kind of star in another term here. But we think, as a rule, these things have planets. All the stars usually have planets, and we're going to need them. There's also some consideration that we'll talk about a little bit later. What happens if you get a civilization that manages to leave its planet?
Tom, can I ask you a question?
Yeah.
You and Drake keep talking about civilizations. Has anybody ever challenged the use of that term in the social science?
We'll get there.
Okay.
We'll get there. There's a term for that that was considered. Or at least I would consider it. So here's our big consideration. This next term, N sub E. This is really, I call it places that are just right. This is a big one. A very big one. This is what Drake called it, the average number of planets that can potentially support life per star that has planets. This is state of the art right now. As far as potentially habitable exoplanets, 32 of them. And calling these potentially habitable is potentially. This is a we'd sure like to think, you know. And then, I mean, here's for comparison, Mars and Earth and Jupiter and Neptune that are over here, right? So you can compare the ones we think are potentially habitable. These are all bigger than Earth, notice, right? That might pose problem. We don't know. It might, but we really don't know. Here's the original estimate by the group at Green Bank in 1961. 1 to 5. They became less sure as they progressed through these terms. Or there was more debate. I'm sure they talked about the potential. They said, well, of the stars that have planets, we'll get between 1 and 5. Let's talk about this a little bit. We've got to look at the habitable zone. Now, if you've looked into exoplanets much, you'll know this habitable zone up here. This habitable zone is perhaps more important for our discussion. This is our galaxy, or a galaxy. Doesn't really matter. We'll call it our galaxy since I put the sun here. So, this habitable zone is the galactic habitable zone. We'll call this one a circumstellar habitable zone, to apply generally to any star. There's still a lot of debate out there about the existence of this. There are some people say, a lot of people criticize this, but let's look at the arguments for first. You get close into the middle of the galaxy, you get a lot of ionizing radiation. A lot of ionizing radiation. Ionizing radiation is well known to destroy life, even microbial life. This is gamma rays, X-rays, ultraviolet, electromagnetic radiation. It'll kill you. So we don't think, I don't think, if you get too close in here, that you're going to find stuff that's alive. Now, maybe there's some planets that can shield it. Yeah, this is a big maybe. Right? Why not out here, though? Well, it turns out that there's this thing called metallicity. And it sounds like it's a metal, like, you know, tin and stuff. No, we're talking metal as defined by astrophysicists, which happens to include things like oxygen, carbon, stuff that we think, based on what we know now, you need for life. We could be completely and utterly wrong. But we think you need oxygen and carbon. And if you get too far out into the outer reaches of the galaxy here on the outer spiral arm, the metallicity of stars drops up. You get mostly hydrogen and not a whole lot else. And so we don't think there's enough of the right stuff out here to produce any kind of habitable anything. But there are some considerations there. There are some pretty legit computer simulations that suggest stars might start in here, where they pick up this metallicity and they have the right stuff, and then they migrate out. Yeah. There's. Do we have a lot of evidence for that? No. We've got a computer simulation or two, but. But maybe, right? We haven't looked very much, right? In fact, where we've looked, all this exoplanet stuff, if the sun's right here, we've looked in a region a little bit bigger than my laser pointer there. to find all the exoplanets we found. So we're just learning about this stuff, really. I think there's a pretty good argument for a galactic habitable zone. Maybe it's a little bit fuzzy around the edges. But if we're going to look for life, our best bet is to look for what we know for sure is definitely life, something carbon-based-ish like us. There might be something else that could survive all the radiation in here, or maybe doesn't need all that other stuff and be out here. But we've never ever seen anything like that, so going looking for it seems like a waste of time. But this, all the definitions of all of both of these types of habitable zones really depend on life as we know it. We gotta stick with that. Searching for something we know something about is better than, you know, the unknown we're just gonna have to stumble on. This habitable zone is known as the Goldilocks zone, the circumstellar one. You gotta, too close to your star, too hot. Too far away, too cold. Just right. So we think that, that in this just right region is, provides for the existence of liquid water on the surface of the planet. We think you need some liquid water for this stuff to happen, for a lot of good reasons. Biochemistry, not the least of ones that do. We think we need some liquid water to make that happen. But this is emerging science. The habitable zone is a relatively new thing. And figuring out exactly what it is that we need there is an ongoing process. So, these places that are just right, there's the original guess by Drake and co. No clue. So, this is sort of consensus I found, rough consensus amongst experts, somewhere between 0 and 5. My guess, I'm going to say less than 1. This is a number less than 1, because being just right is pretty special. You got to be just right galactically, you got to be just right around your star, and we're starting to learn you got to be just right with the planet's atmosphere. And we're just barely getting to look at exoplanet atmospheres right now and getting an idea what they are. So, you know, Venus could be argued to be in the habitable zone of our own star. We're not going to survive on Venus. It's way too hot. The atmosphere is crazy thick. You melt lead on the surface. Mars could be argued to be in the habitable zone of our own star, the Sun. It's way too cold there, at least now. But
what about a lot consideration of the percentage of exoplanetary systems with planets in highly elliptical orbits, those hot Jupiters that go real close and swing way out that will disturb
and
the...
That's another reason I say this has got to be less than 1. What Jim's talking about, let me go back here. These look like pretty circular orbits. That means you stay in the just right zone. There are some, and you got to stay here. The other thing that can happen, he's talking about these hot Jupiters, big planets, they come in, they're big like Jupiter, but they come in these weird orbits that are kind of elliptical like this, like comets. But they might come in and get close to this planet that was just right and drag it out of the way. And mess it up so that it is no longer just right. And we think there are a lot of these hot Jupiters out there, based on our exoplanet studies. There are a fair number of them that are out there messing up the orbits of any other planets in their solar systems. That's why I say this has got to be pretty special. You got to be really special to be just right, to have your planet in the right spot. And there's a lot of things that can mess it up. Where you are in the galaxy, where you are compared to your star, other stuff in your neighborhood around your star can also mess you up. Another consideration would be binary stars. Their habitable zones oscillate. You might be a planet orbiting a binary star system, and you might be in the habitable zone for half of your orbit, but not for all of your orbit. It'll wobble around, these wobbly habitable zones. It's very, very special to be in the right place. And so I think this is less than 1. And in fact, my guess would be considerably less. But I'll go for optimism and say 1 at the very outside, almost certainly less than that. That's what I think. So here's the next term in here. F sub L, And this is really, does this just happen? And so the fraction of planets that could support life, that are in the right place, that actually get life, that develop some life. And we're not even talking about civilization yet. We're talking about reproducing little bits of stuff.
An extremophile.
Drake and company has said, oh, well, surely if you can have it, you will. This is wildly optimistic. This is arguably crazy. And I think this their original guest, a bunch of physicists, they're like, sure, cool, call it one. Good enough. Move on, right? Given our experimental sample size, currently we have one measurement. And it sure did. And I think that's maybe what they argued. Oh, well, it started here, so why not elsewhere? Well, because a lot of reasons. Far too numerous to get into here. But given our thoroughly incomplete understanding of what it takes to get this going, don't get me wrong, we're getting better at this. But we are far from knowing really what needs to happen to start life. We don't, and given our one place to study, we're even further off. Anybody that claims to know this one, have solved this term for sure, is lying or selling stuff.
Or both.
Probably both. One of the reasons, this term in the Drake equation is one of our reasons to go to Mars.
Yes.
If we find that life on Mars, there was some life, even an extremophile, even some little tiny fossilized bacteria, if there was once upon a time life on Mars that developed independently of life on Earth, we can start to make some revisions to this. And so looking elsewhere in our solar system for life is important. Is really important for this term. But again, We gotta knock out the original guess here. If this fraction is somewhere between 0 and 1, I'm guessing pretty close to the lower bound here. But we really don't know. We really have no idea what it takes. It could be anywhere in this range. I can't help but be pessimistic about this, again, because it doesn't just happen. I did read an article there. There's a physicist at MIT that says, no, life is likely to happen. So if he's right, and there's some thermodynamics arguments to support him, and he's come up with some, he's a smart guy. If he's right, maybe it's closer to one. And life does just happen. Given some time. How much time? Well, we don't know. I think this term comes down to we haven't the slightest idea. But we're working on it. A bunch of people much smarter than I are working on this one. And hopefully we can end up with some consensus on this eventually. So here's the big one.
Yeah.
At least for me. Really,
oh, yeah.
We say, just because you get life, do you ever get intelligence? And really, Drake, and it's sort of implicit in all of it, they talk about intelligence, they really mean civilizations. Yet, as was brought up, what's meant by
civilization?
Is this a civilization?
Yes.
Is this?
Certainly.
This?
Certainly. But none of them are in.
But none of them, you know, these guys aren't building radio telescopes. Not even Gutenberg here is building radio telescopes, right? There's the original estimate.
Wow.
Drake and company said, well, surely if you get life, then we'll develop a civilization. Crazy. Again, absolutely insane. There's no way that this is a one-to-one. There are lots and lots and lots of things that can happen. Yeah. There are lots of things that can happen between extremophile little bacteria, right? And again, our sample size of, our true sample size of one, we don't know. We simply don't know. But people are working on it. Most people that are working on it are saying, no, this is pretty close to zero. There's a lot that can happen. Even if life starts up, what about snowball Earth? Everything gets too cold for too long, and everything dies.
What about if the asteroid that knocked out the dinosaurs would have been 10 miles wide instead of only 6?
Extinction events like asteroid impacts and comets and, you know. And you might argue that in this term, we should include those hot Jupiter sort of events as extinction events. This hot Jupiter comes by and spins us out of the habitable zone, so we're no longer in the right place.
Even
all
intelligent sorts of life doesn't mean civilization. They may know better than the developed civilization.
Yeah. And it was really implicit to Drake and company that what they meant by intelligent life was civilization. It is not so clear to other people, particularly biologists, to say, now, wait a minute. Just because you're intelligent doesn't mean you form a civilization. And so this is one of the terms that gets a lot of modifications made to it. And people say, let's throw it out and let's make this term into 2 or 3 or 4 or 5 or 100. Usually 2 or 3. And amongst those is, well, let's get intelligent life. Dolphins are pretty smart, but I don't think anybody's arguing that there's dolphin civilization.
Okay.
And then let's get intelligent life. Then let's have another term that talks about the development of a civilization. But taken together as a single term, probably pretty close to zero. Not the wildly optimistic one as proposed by Drake and cohorts in 1961. But even if you get a civilization, you're still not there yet, turns out.
Yeah.
You gotta get high tech. Here's this second to last term of the equation, F sub C. The fraction of civilizations that develop a technology that releases detectable signs of their existence into space. That's what Drake originally said.
Mm-hmm.
And here's their original estimate, a tenth to a fifth. They were, a little pessimistic about that. But I think you gotta expand this a little bit and say, I thought they should be able to detect us in some way, Drake. And then they kind of threw that out here. There's a big difference between a civilization that builds radio towers and leaks out some stuff, right? We're sending TV signals around with big powerful transmitters so that everybody in the neighborhood can hear us, or powerful AM broadcasts so that you can bounce some things off the ionosphere. But some stuff leaks out. There's a big difference between this and the Voyager saying, this is what we look like, here's where we are, come get us. There's a big difference between leaking stuff and sending stuff. So even if you say, well, let's look at the fraction of civilizations that develop a technology that produces any of this radiation. Even if you say that, they might not do it on purpose. And if they're not doing it on purpose, that's going to drive this number a lot lower. I don't think we can say that at all. I think that's another one we don't know anything about.
Your adjective detectable over there is important, too.
Yeah.
You have to think about signal-to-noise ratios.
Yeah, detectable... this detectable, it almost implies, and I think these are Drake's words here. I think what was implicit to those people was, if you're going to be detectable, you're going to do it on purpose.
Basically, that's true.
And that is essentially true, but what's detectable to us versus what's detectable to somebody else is an unknown, and that's why I expanded this. This is another of the heck if I know terms. Because we don't really, our sample size is one. We know what we can detect. We don't have the slightest idea what anybody else can detect.
Tom, when I was first fooling around with Project SETI, I thought what I was looking for was like, I Love Lucy from Alpha Centauri or something like that. But I later found out that if you're going to get a signal from Alpha Centauri, it's going to be from something the size of the Puerto Rico telescope, the ABM radar in Krasnoyarsk, Siberia. It's going to be a huge, powerful thing that's specifically engineered to do that.
Yeah, and that's based on what we know how to do. And again,
that's true.
We don't know what everybody else knows how to do.
That's true.
We just don't know. Now, if I were to venture a guess, I'd again put it pretty close to the zero, because this takes a lot of, you almost have to do it on purpose.
Yes.
You know, and maybe it gets better if you send in stuff like Voyager out, maybe somebody else has done that, and there's the alien Voyager on its way, and it's sending stuff, and we'll pick it up, but, you know, if the sending device is constantly getting closer, our chances are going up and up all the time. But we simply don't know. Again, this is, you can see the trouble in researching this is, there's a lot of, well, we don't know.
Huge error bars.
Huge error bars. This is one, this last term is of consideration. How long does a civilization last? So, and really, the way Drake says it, how long do these civilizations that we think are pretty rare already, how long do they actually release their detectable signals? For how long do they do that? Assuming that there's an alien out there with much better detection technology than us, we've been doing this for less than 100 years. So let's be optimistic and call it. Here's what Drake and company said. Oh, 1,000 to a lot. Right?
Is that years?
That's years.
Yes.
They think this many years,
100
right?
100 million years.
100 million years. Drake and company said, oh, well, surely civilizations will do this for somewhere between 1,000 and 100 million years. I don't think so. We'll be optimistic and we'll say, we'll do it for at least as long as we've done it so far. There's our one sample, our sample size of one. This and even this is giving us something. This is saying our tiny little radio transmissions are somehow detectable somewhere, which is probably not true.
We'll
throw
a statistic that the average lifespan of a species in fossil record is 8 million years. Not 100 million, not 100.
Yeah.
It's 8 million.
8 million years.
Years.
So
it's a lot less than.
So, that. I stopped this at 100,000. In my guess, and it's just I'm just. Because there's lots of ways for civilizations to destroy this. You know, you just wear out, go away, you know, or we burn the place up, or we blow it up, right? There's all sorts of ways in which we can bring our own civilization down and stop sending signals, whether we're doing so on purpose or not, right? The other consideration in this lifetime is that typically, if we're going to make this a detectable signal, like we said, probably doing it on purpose. Probably. Now, we haven't really done that. Our civilization. We haven't on purpose sent out signals to that star or that star. Not, you know, arguably once.
Yeah, from Puerto Rico to...
Yeah.
From the air, but
this is an arguable. We shot something out there, but another thought on here is that if you can do it on purpose, and you're going to do it on purpose, you probably have also developed the ability to do this to your civilization.
But why do you have to be doing it on purpose? Isn't the whole part of the Drake equation to detect how many places there might be life?
There might be, yeah. And
so what makes that life have to want to let us know they're there?
Why we say you almost have to be, and I say almost have to, is to make it detectable. Mm-hmm. Because even the closest thing nearby, even the next star system over, Alpha Centauri, even if we go there, the amount of energy that you've got to leak out, if you're just broadcasting in all directions, by the time it gets to us, your, you know, terawatt transmitter is producing a teeny tiny signal when it reaches Earth. By the time you spread out that huge amount of power over a sphere, even a few light years in radius, the signal is so small that it's probably below the level of radio noise from other things that just happen naturally in the universe. That's why we think it's up on. But again, the detectable is what we know of as detectable. Detectable by somebody else might be something else. Might be much, much smaller. Maybe they've set up some kind of lock-in system you can pick it with. Lock-in amplifiers are explicitly built to pick out very small signals from noisy things. You can do it on purpose, but you kind of have to know what you're looking for to use that sort of tech. We may not be looking in the right place.
Well, one of the things that they're thinking of is optical setting. Instead of radio, maybe a laser of some sort, a laser of some kind.
And that's a way to concentrate that power. Is to shoot, but then you don't do it everywhere, you have to send it
directly,
right? And that's why we think that's an on purpose, but we really just think that. We don't know that. Further lending my credence to my 0 to 1 estimates in previous terms. It could be anywhere in there. We don't know what it takes. We don't really know what it takes to detect. We're guessing based on our knowledge of physics now what it takes to detect. But there's the last term. How long does it last? Let me go here. There are lots of modifications to this. I had to put the Calvin and Hobbes in here. You can read that. That's pretty good. But most people agree. Most people studying this, and I think even Drake would probably cop to this. Maybe not in public, but if you talk to him, this is at best an incomplete equation. And generally not terribly useful for its stated purpose, because we have all these things we know nothing about. However, it starts a conversation, and it starts to tell us about what we might need to know. When he said, I've written down everything I need that we would need to know to determine. No, not really. But you started us out on the path of what might we need to know? What should we look into? What should we try and figure out? I think we should be asking a few different questions. And the experts agree with me, is the short of this. People that really do this on a more full-time basis have come up with many different questions, usually related to terms in the Drake equation. But maybe we should span those out. So I'm going to go through reasonably quickly, some proposed modifications that I thought were interesting. Colonization. What happens when you have civilizations that advance sufficiently to colonize other star systems? Is the person that really brought this up. The person that brought this idea up originally said other star systems, but maybe even other planets in their own star system. What if you spread out enough? Maybe you get a little bit closer. And especially if you get into other star systems, then you're talking about the ability to transmit further, and then if you're another, you're probably trying to communicate back and forth, and there might be some pretty big signals there, right? We're going to have to get lined up with one of them. They're probably directional signals at this point. But, you know, you can include these additional effects, colonizations. We don't have any evidence for this, right? Again, sample size. We know of our civilization, and we haven't done this. So, our best measurement to date says this doesn't happen. Right?
Also, if you had something like your photograph on the right over there, accelerating to about 2/10 C or something like that, wouldn't that leave a contrail big enough to be spotted?
Yeah.
Pretty much
if you do this at sufficiently large speed, you're going to start emitting detectable signals. So this may increase things a little bit. Some of the proponents of a term covering colonization say you really need to take the original number from the Drake equation and then sum it over some some amount of colonization, amount of work, and I don't know that I would go that far. I don't think we need to start adding up stuff, but these are considerations, and the very real ones. If you've got civilizations that can do this kind of stuff, they're going to be emitting bigger signals, at least. And therefore more detectable signals. And they're almost certainly going to be capable of hearing something from us. So, a good term, and arguably we should put something in. Somewhere. There is absolutely no consensus as to should we include this in some other term, some existing term in the Drake equation? Should we make it its own term? Do we need to rewrite a new equation that uses the Drake equation as input? I don't know. And nobody else can decide on this. But, again, if this does happen, we don't know about it. Maybe we should start on it ourselves, and then we'll be able to figure out more about it. Here's another one that I thought was interesting. The reappearance factor. Just because you blow yourselves up, that doesn't prohibit another civilization from rising from the ashes, right? Maybe they should call it the Phoenix factor or something flashier like that, right? The reappearance factor sounds rather dull. But you know, what if this was dinosaurs and we just don't know that because it was so long ago we haven't found any evidence of it, right? Or what if we blew ourselves up and we get back to something like this and you know we start emitting EM again, you know, we start emitting this electromagnetic radiation again. And so, how many times? Well, again, given our current measurements of what we know has happened, this hasn't ever happened, as far as we know. So, how do you assign a value to that? You probably call it zero. It doesn't happen. But, could it? Sure. Maybe there are some good arguments for this. Particularly around main sequence sorts of stars. That gets back to the issues of stars, but shorter lived stars, this would have to be a function of what kind of star are you nearby. Because this can only happen so many times before the star does bad stuff to your planet, right? This guy proposed this, the messaging extraterrestrial intelligence factor. And these are his words. This is his exact quote from this guy. He's worked with SETI. He says, the fraction of communicative civilizations with clear and non-paranoid planetary consciousness. Maybe they're out there trying to send us signals, for sure. And I would argue maybe this goes into one of the other terms in the Drake equation, really. Are they doing it on purpose, right? Are they really doing it on purpose? And I think that's what he's after is if they're absolutely for sure trying to communicate with aliens on purpose, we should include that as a factor in the equation, but I don't know. But yeah, this guy's a legit scientist. He works on radar astronomy, near-Earth asteroid research, and SETI. So maybe he's on to something. I would call this the on-purpose factor, if we're going to call it a different factor. Although, as we discussed, I think the on-purpose is kind of in there implicitly in detectable. It's reasonably unlikely, given our knowledge of physics, that unless a signal is sent on purpose, we won't see it. So, here's my favorite. This was proposed in Popular Science in July 2013, the Dalek variable. It says, of the civilizations that make it to all the other qualifications, how many survive the extermination event from another alien species that have come in and have wiped them out? Anybody know these guys from Doctor Who? Exterminate, right? Yeah. They're going to come in and wipe everybody out. You might argue that this is sort of implicitly included in that lifetime variable. This is one of the ways in which your civilization can end. some other civilization kills you.
Okay. Wouldn't that answer the ultimate question that there's another life form?
Yes. Then we would know, right?
Exactly. Before,
the other consideration for this though is, if they can do this, if the Daleks can land and wipe out the civilization that might have communicated, they're probably communicating. Mm-hmm. Right? They're probably emitting those kinds of signals that we might be able to see. So, yeah. I like that one just because I think realistically you should include it in the lifetime. This is one of the ways, an extremely unlikely way that a civilization might end. But why not? Since we know nothing about that anyway, we'll throw in alien invasion as a way for your civilization to end. So, how many are there? What's the answer? What's N? Here's the range that I could find any consensus on. This is tiny. 4 times 10 to the minus 12 is a tiny, tiny number. So these people say, nope, we're it. For certain. And in fact, with these people, with this estimate, we're it anywhere in the universe. Not just our galaxy. And our galaxy was Drake's. But then there are some people that look at this. 36 million. High end. Right? Maybe there's 36 million in the galaxy. They're just far away, or they already died out, or who knows? Drake and his people said somewhere between 20 and 50 million. And then Drake later goes on to say, considering the uncertainties we have in all these terms, he says that the number should be approximately equal to his lifetime estimate, which I thought the lifetime estimate of these was wildly optimistic as well. So Drake is really saying between 1,000 and 100 million. Here's what I say. Heck if I know. Most of this is uncertainty. The vast majority of this is uncertainty. And I'm an experimentalist. I like to make measurements. That means we should keep measuring. Let's do it. Let's use the Drake equation as a starting point to what do we try to measure. This is going to take a lot of interdisciplinary collaboration. The traditional boundaries of sciences, physicists and chemists and biologists, we're going to have to sit down in a room and figure out how to talk to each other if we're ever going to make any progress on this thing. Because there's a lot of information that needs to go into this. If you're going to pin me down on a number, I'm going to guess there's about us. Going into this research, you get optimistic. Yeah, there's got to be. Surely there are some intelligent aliens that we could talk to. Well, I don't know. If we're gonna say how many civilizations are there that we can talk to, and say we can talk to ourselves, that's.
And we're not.
That's it. Yeah, and I say approximately one because arguably it could be zero if we don't count. I think that's a very real possibility. We may not count at all. But we just really don't know. We just really, really don't know. However, let's be optimistic. We'll go to the Mr. Optimism of Science here. Look what he says. Life doesn't exist anywhere but here. Well, that's like dipping a cup in the ocean and saying, well, there must not be whales. We haven't looked very hard. The problem with this outlook is we can't look very hard. We don't know how to look hard. We don't know how to get more than a cup out of the ocean. And so, statistically, yeah, we think they're out there, but we're probably never going to talk to them. I like this one, though. This is pretty optimistic here. First ant colony, they go around looking for pheromones, and they don't find them, so we must not exist.
That's funny. The ants seem to find me often enough.
Yeah, but maybe we're not looking for the right stuff, right? And I found this one, and I just had to laugh, because really, this comes down to this last term that was inserted by the XKCD author, says, how much are you willing to buy from Frank Drake? this is really the we don't know factor here. My thoughts on this are really, is there intelligent life somewhere out there in the universe? I think that statistics, the law of large number, when you consider the whole universe, totally on the side, there's intelligent life somewhere. But the Drake equation is, do we ever get to talk to them? Do we ever get to interact with these other aliens at all? And I say the answer to that is almost certainly not. And until we break, remember that rule I mentioned first, that speed of light communication rule. Until we figure out a way around that, we're not going to get to talk to anybody else. So if you want to figure the way around that, study general relativity, figure out what's wrong with it, tell us how to make a wormhole, and we'll go find some aliens. Don't forget, April 9th, Mike Thomas is talking about Leonardo da Vinci. If you haven't seen it before, that's interesting. And he tells me he's making some changes, so we'll see what comes of that. That's on the 9th of April, which is that 2 weeks? Yeah, it's 2 weeks. So check back in a couple of weeks. How's the skies? Thumbs down, that's what I'm getting at, let me check. We're guessing not great, but come by if you'd like to see the telescopes in the back. We'll be happy to show you the big guys. And we're here every Saturday. Thanks for coming.